So what is the problem that we're trying to solve? We heard pretty loudly from the community that that the CLI confines users to basically the feature sets that we decide to deliver, and we heard that that confinement didn't sit well with people. Basically, you know, we tried to expose the APIs, expose functionality of the APIs in commands. So there's a lot of things you can do with the CLI that were just out of scope for what our team shuttered to deliver. So we came up with plugins. The main thing that we wanted to make sure we did is make the command line extensible. If we didn't do that, we pretty much failed. There'd be no reason for plugins. The second thing we wanted to do is make sure that plugins acted and interacted exactly like core CLI commands do today, so that there were, there's a seamless interaction between the two. And then the third thing we wanted to make sure that we did was make plugins discoverable and installable natively within the CLI. So as we were going through that conversation amongst ourselves, what it is that we wanted to do, I remembered that we incepted on plugins. We had an epic in our tracker, and in that we took notes about our inception. The goals and the scope are an interesting thing to revisit. The goals we had internally, those are the things for the team. Like, you guys don't care that we wanted to have a shippable MVP for November 1st. But the scope's really interesting. It's the thing that we call the four things. It's kind of the mantra for plugins. The first one is that plugins are executed by typing cf space and then the command name, the plugin name. It's exactly the way that the core CLI works today. The second one is that a plugin author or developer could write help, and that help, help. That's good. Did I do that with a clicker, or is that you guys? Anyway, that you could write help and that it would interact with the existing help structure for the CLI, so that when you type CF help, help about plugins comes up, as well as help about the existing CLI. The third thing is that plugins didn't exist in a vacuum on their own, that they could call core commands, and that core commands could be then a part of the functionality that plugin delivers. And then the last thing is that they can take arguments and flags exactly like the core commands do. So, Jonathan?
Okay, so I'm going to talk briefly about the use cases for plugins. This is sort of the, you know, expected uses we were thinking of when we began developing them. So Greg mentioned that we're from disparate companies. We're an open source team. All the projects we work on are open source. So that was really what we personally had in mind when we began developing these. Now, that's not to say that we didn't take into account private use cases. We also, every step of the way as we were developing the architecture and infrastructure that we're using for plugins, we made sure to keep an eye to make these usable for enterprise cases. So if you, you know, want to provide functionality to your customers, you can use plugins to do that. Our main goal, as Greg mentioned, was to extend the CLI command set through a common API. So what this means is we're really looking to create functionality for the CLI beyond what the three people standing in front of you can do in our day jobs. The CLI, as it continues to grow, as Cloud Foundry continues to grow, you know, the things people are going to need the CLI to do for them is going to grow and grow and grow. And the three of us cannot really keep up with that need. So the hope is that by allowing users to extend the CLI beyond the pre-existing API, that not only will they, you know, create things for their own uses, but that the community will collaborate amongst themselves and continue to grow, rather than just collaborating sort of with us, the mainline CLI team. They'll work together. No? Okay, so just some brief examples of the sort of plugins we've seen in the community so far. The first use case is sort of something we've labeled sort of ephemeral plugins. Under our own work on the CLI team itself, we've encountered numerous things which are use cases that are sort of time-boxed explicitly. For instance, Diego Beta. So for those of you who aren't familiar with what Diego is, Diego is the next generation backend for Cloud Foundry. It's currently being in, you know, it's in development. It's not quite ready for prime time just yet, but it's under work. You can go and download it and use it today. And so there are certain features that Diego supports that the mainline backend to Cloud Foundry currently doesn't. And some of our users expressed a desire to be able to use the CLI to interact with Diego. And that's great. There's a couple problems with that, though. We didn't want to include Diego commands in the regular CLI because they might get, you know, confuse users who don't know what Diego is. If they use them targeting a normal Cloud Foundry, strange things might happen and confuse our users. So this was a perfect use case for us to write a plugin, because now we have a plugin called Diego Beta. It contains all of the subsets of features that are unique to Diego at this point in time. And if you want, you can go download it in one place, just one plugin, and it comes with, you know, roughly a dozen commands at this point. And it's all neatly contained in one, nicely in one place. And then when Diego becomes the de facto backend for Cloud Foundry, we can just merge that functionality into the mainline CLI. CF App Stack Changer. So about a month ago now, Ubuntu, or Canonical, I should say, sunset support for Ubuntu Lucid. And many of the backends on Cloud Foundry, the DEAs, were using Lucid, and so we had a need to migrate all of these backends to the trusty, so that, you know, security features and stuff still get updated. So this is the sort of thing that someone's only ever going to need to do this once. You know, once that's upgraded to trusty, they're not going to do it, you know, ever again. So this was, again, something that was very integral to our, you know, our users needed to do this. It's a pretty serious security issue, but they're only ever going to need to do this once. So we wrote a plugin that does it. You run, you know, download the plugin, run it once, uninstall it, forget about it. And then novel functionality. So this is a sort of a different area. This is something that maybe is some area of functionality that the CLI isn't directly concerned with. Something that, but is still, you know, useful to a user as sort of a quality of life improvement, or a use case like interacting with an app or a service directly, which we don't really concern ourselves with. So CLI Recorder and Opener, two that Simon's actually going to show you. CLI Recorder is actually written by our very own Simon Leung. It's a thing to record and replay macros. So you can have subsets of commands that you can execute quickly in the CLI itself. Open is just a simple, you type CF open in your app name, and it opens up a browser that, you know, goes directly to your app, so you can see what's running on Cloud Foundry. And then I'm going to pass it to Simon, who's going to demo some plugins for you all.
So when we... Is that volume? I can hear. Okay. So when we first set out to design the plugin architecture, we envisioned the plugin is going to allow a wide range of functionality enabled for the CLI. And some of the functionality might be easy to use, and some of them might be harder for the user to use. So it was our goal that a user should be able to get plugin commands help easily. So today, all the plugins command, they are listed in the CF help alongside with all the native command. And if you need additional help for any given command, all you have to do is to give the help flag. For example, so can you guys see the font clearly? I can enlarge it a little bit.
Bigger.
Good? Yep, okay. So this is a CF help menu, and all the install all the plugins that's installed locally is under this category right here. And if you want to look at any additional help for a particular command, for example, record, all you have to do is CF record, and the help flag. That's going to show you the detailed usage and options for a command. And so looking at this, getting help for a plugin command is basically the same as getting help from a native command. And that's good for the user, because that's really nothing new for you to learn. And going to the second goal, at the plugin design, we want user to be able to run a plugin just like running a native plugin, native command. And let me show you what I mean. So let's start by listing what kind of local plugins I have installed in the system. So CF plugins will give you a list of plugins installed, and I have CLI recorder, live stats, and open. So the recorder will record a set of CLI commands which you can play back at a later time. And the live stats, it shows you a live usage stats of any application in the browser. It's pretty neat, and I will show you in a bit. The open, like Jonathan said, it's a very simple plugin. It's one of those plugins that make your life a little bit easier. It opens the application in the browser for you, so you don't have to manually type in the URL. To use it, you simply just CF and then a command open, and then application you want to open. I have an application in my environment called plugins. It returns a list of community share plugin, and I'm going to use that as a sample plugin. So to use the CF open plugins, and what it does, it opens a default route to my application in the browser. But in my case, my application actually have two routes bounded to it. So it's asking me which one to open. So I'll just pick the first one. And the browser opened the application, and I don't have to do anything. That's pretty neat. This is a list of the available plugins in the community. And we have CL recorder here, and we have live stats. Live stats monitor the CPU and memory usage in a browser. And to use it, let me show you how to use it. Use the CF live stats, and then the application you want to monitor. And since we have plugin open in the browser, let's use that, plugins. So what the plugin does is it runs a local server, which you can access in the browser. So let's copy the URL and open the browser to access the page. And that opens up a page with two graphs. The upper graph shows you the usage of the CPU, and the lower one shows you the usage of the memory. So if I access application by reloading the page like once, twice, I should see a spike in the CPU. So you see there's three lines. Actually, that's probably other people using it too, so that's a good thing. So you see there's actually three lines in the graph, and that's only because the plugins is actually running on three different instances. So each of this line represents a single instance. So this is very neat. And as you can see, the plugin can give you functionality that native CLI can never give you. And the plugin developers, they're taking advantage of that. You can see there's more and more plugin coming available every single day. But all these plugin developers, they usually face a common problem they usually have to solve is how to get all these plugins to the end user. And there's a reason we make CLI repository. So with a CLI plugin repository, it's a CLI server that the CLI can, it's a plugin server that the CLI can interact directly to browse and to install plugins. If you have a recent CLI version installed, you can go to the help of the CLI. So let's stop this. Pull up the help menu. And you can see under this category that are there are commands that you can interact with the plugin server directly. That you can add and remove plugin repo, and you can list what's locally installed on your computer. And you, if you want to look at what plugins are available in the plugin server, you can use the repo plugin commands. So let's look at what plugin repos are on my local system right now available. We can use the list plugin repos command, CF. As you can see, we have only a single repo called CF on my local computer. And this is actually the official CLI repo hosted by the CLI team. It contains all the repository. It contains all the plugins shared by the community. And all these plugins are open source. And if I choose to, I can add another repository to my local system. And to do that, I use the CF add plugin repo command. And this is usage. To use that, you have to supply the repo name and the URL. The repo name is pretty much anything you want to name it. It's pretty much for your own remembering. And the URL is the web address to the repository. And I just happen to have a local development server, a Clipper server that's running on my system, so I can use that as demonstration. So CF add repo, and then a name, I will just call it local, as in local server. And then the web address, which is my local computer. And I know it's running on port 3000. So it's added, and to verify, we can just use the list command to make sure it's already added. So now I have CF repo and I have local repo. And if I want to see what's available within these two repo, I use the CF repo plugins command. So as you can see here, there's a long list of available plugins for the community repo. And in my local repo, there's only a single sample plugin. And if I want to install one of these plugin, I can use the install command cf install plugin. And with the install plugin command, you have a few options what to do. The first one, you can grab the you can install with a plugin binary that you get from the plugin author. And another option is you can install the plugin you can install with a URL to the plugin binary. And the third option is like to install the plugin that is in our plugin repository. So to do that, I can just do cf install plugin and then the name of the plugin in the repository. For example, if I want to install targets, I will do cf install plugin targets, and then the name of the repository, which is cf. So what the CLI does right now is trying to determine what kind of operating system you're running, and you will figure out which binary you should download and install in your local system. This process should be pretty fast because the plugin is actually not that big in size, but it really depends on our internet connection speed. So it should be anytime now. I think the binary is around 8 meg in size. If your process is configured correctly, yes, it will. Oh, with the CLI one. No, currently this install process, it just goes directly to the URL. So it needs access to the URL directly. Okay. All right. I'll get to that. So here I show that like the interaction between CLI and the repository. And the second goal of Creeper is ready to use. So Creeper is an open source project. And so if anyone, they just clone the repository, it's ready to use out of the box. You can run it as a standalone executable, or if you have a CF environment, Creeper is actually CF ready, so you can just push to any environment that you have. With that, like you can, like CLI team, you can use Creeper to host plugins for the community, so they can share all the open source community with each other. Or if you're an organization, you can probably use Creeper to host plugins that's specific to your environment, and you can share all these plugins with your clients or customer. And other than being a production-ready server, Creeper is also an architecture reference. Creeper is both a number of REST API interface to interact with CLI. So anyone can easily implement your own version of Creeper by implementing the correct CLI signature. And with that, you can easily extend the Creeper's functionality, such as user authentication or any functionality that you wish to make. So here I have showed the CLI interaction, the plugin usage, and the distribution model. And here I would like to pass back to Jonathan, and he's going to bring you through the rest of the topics.
Okay, I would like to briefly mention what exactly is the CLI plugin. So we've shown what you can do with them, and I would like to briefly touch on what exactly you have to write if you actually want to make one. So currently, we only support one language for our plugins, which is Golang. That's what the CLI itself is written in. Just to keep things sort of simple, as well as take advantage of the particular strengths that Golang offers us. So for those not familiar with Golang, it's a language developed by Google in the past couple years. That's sort of its target audience is thing, you know, concurrent environments. We actually use it for a couple other things, such as the cross-compile binary feature. So regardless of what OS or architecture that you develop on, Golang has the capability to produce binaries for any of the disparate architectures that CLI supports, which is currently 32 and 64-bit Windows, 32 and 64-bit Linux, as well as Darwin. So regardless of what you're writing your plugin on, you can distribute it to users on any of those five operating systems. The single executable file is another nice feature. So you've written your plugin, you've compiled it, the end result, rather than being a tarball of stuff that your user has to download and put in the right places, and then you have to have dependency set up, is a single executable file that will execute anywhere, regardless even if they don't have Go installed, as long as you are running it on the right environment. So this kind of combines to create something that's highly portable, it's easy to distribute, it's easy to install. So the future, where are we going with plugins? We are currently working on a selection of new features, which we hope to get out in the near future. A couple of things we're working on, making the plugin API simpler to use so that it's easier to write plugins, it's easier to interact with the Cloud Foundry from within your plugin. We're also working on instituting version checking within the CLI itself. So, you know, if your plugin depends on features that were more recently introduced, you can say, I require at least the CLI version X, so that, you know, your user will see that, you know, they need to upgrade their CLI in order to use your plugin instead of this, the, you know, CLI exploding or something like that. I'm going to briefly pass it off to Greg. He's going to sort of wrap us up.
I didn't remember that I was going to wrap this up. So it says closing up, so I'm closing up. I guess that we have a few minutes for questions. Are there any questions?
Yes.
Where's a good place to go to get developer documentation?
Ah, that's a great question. The question is, where is a good place to go to get developer documentation?
So the best way to do it is go to our CLI GitHub repository. Mm-hmm. And let me just show you that. And in here, if you go down, you will see plugin development. There's a link down there.
It's for development.
Oh, right here. So in the developing session, there's a link for developing guide on writing a CLI plugin. See here. Mm-hmm. So here you will find a link and also samples for plugins, the architecture. How to write a plugin, and also there's a link for you to go to the CLI plugin repository.
There's examples too.
Yeah, there's examples. So if you want to look at examples of the plugin, you go to.
There's a link.
So all these are actually examples. You have basic plugin, how to make an interactive plugin, how to make a plugin with multiple commands, and if you want to do TDD. And that's an example of how to develop using our fake CLI connection. And all the samples are here.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I've actually found that. I've played around with the examples. They're pretty good. I'm looking for more of a comprehensive API document.
Okay. So that's a work in progress. Mm-hmm. We're having this version of API.
Thing is, it's currently in rapid development. We're currently working on it. So it's expected to change in the next week, even.
Or a month, yeah. So they'll be coming, and we will make sure we post a link in the repository.
Mm-hmm. Good. Other questions? No?
Do you have guidance on when to write a plugin or when to just create a script that uses existing CLI commands?
So the hope is that if you are, you know, writing something that's a subset of existing CLI commands, that you would write it as a plugin rather than a script. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're writing it as a script just for your own personal use, that's probably fine. But the problem with scripts is that, you know, they're dependent on the architecture of the shell you're running it in, maybe, you know, things you have set up local to your own environment. So if it's something that you're hoping to provide, you know, to someone other than yourself, you know, they could be running on a Mac instead of Linux, they could, you know, things could be wildly different. So the hope is that one of the main strengths of plugins, one of the main reasons you'd want to use them, is that they're extremely portable. Mm-hmm. That you know that when you give it to another person, it's going to execute the same way it does on your machine.
Mm-hmm. And another thing for me is if you want to make sure your plugin is available to the user, as a plugin, you can take advantage of the plugin repository, and you cannot do so with a script. Mm-hmm.
Okay. To avoid what? I'm sorry.
Duplication.
Oh, sure. Namespace collision issues. So one thing that you can not do is name a plugin the same name as an existing core command. It simply will error out in creating that plugin. Other than that, though, anytime that you try to create a plugin, it checks against a pre-existing name, whether it's a core command or another plugin. So it's almost first come, first serve. But you definitely cannot override a core command.
But yeah, beyond that, we don't have or enforce any real guidelines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the back. Mm-hmm. I think it's Chris up there. Yeah, sure, sure. That makes perfect sense. There'd be a point in time when we would definitely look at taking something into the core. Actually, we saw the open plugin. There were stories in the backlog for that very exact same feature. It got written as a plugin before we got to it, before we got it prioritized into the backlog. So I think there's a point in time, and it would definitely be community driven, right? Something we could talk about in PMC, something that can be talked about in the next generation of VCAP dev, is that CF dev, I think now? And I'm happy to entertain that. That just makes perfect sense. Michael?
Early in the plugin development discussions, there was talk about possibly decomposing the CLI a little bit into plugins.
Mm-hmm.
Where's that going?
The notion of breaking out admin commands is definitely something that we're looking at right now in refactoring help, which gets us a little bit far afield of plugins, but help's difficult because you traverse through so many commands that are for admin only, and if you're not an admin, it's not very helpful. So that notion could extend itself definitely into some kind of decomposition. I'd love to find out what more people think about that and what is meaningful for various kinds of users. I think we're in our last minute, so we have probably time for one more question. Is that a good answer? Okay. Yeah. I plan to integrate with VCO. Yeah, I don't know of a plan, to tell you the truth. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that offline and see what that would mean. Good?
So yeah, we're going to probably have to wrap this up here. I would like to mention that not today, but tomorrow in the afternoon, we actually have open office hours. So if you have questions about plugins or anything else to do with the CLI, feel free to drop by and we can have a chat.
Yeah.
Thank you,
guys.